1600s and up to the mid-1700s, you could actually go and just help yourself to whatever slate you could heave out of the ground, because it was a lot closer to the surface. It didn't require as much, it wasn't as labor intensive as some other forms of quarrying. Although, of course, the deeper you got into a quarry, the tougher it got. But it was available closer to the surface, and that's why you see so much slate. And that's why you see so many different qualities of slate. Some slates are just falling apart, and some, 300-400 years after they were carved, are still in just beautiful, beautiful shape. So thank you, that's very interesting. But I suspect these came from the same place, possibly that quarry, but from the same quarry or from the hands of the same stone cutter, because the handwork is identical.
And the ones in my family are 1819, and they're still very good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's amazing how they look almost new.
Slate is a very good stone to use in this climate. Sadly, marble is not. And marble is what we ended up going to after slate. In 1780, the first white marble quarries were developed in Vermont. But by then, I wrote my dissertation about white marble funerary monuments in America. And I had to start in the 1750s because stonecutters were already importing Carrara white marble from Italy. They knew of this marble long before American sculptors started using it in the 1830s and 40s. And here you see a mourning image where what I love about this image, this is a watercolor. It shows the appeal of the marble, which was that it was white, it was shiny, it was almost sparkly. Brand new marble, white marble, had a real glow to it, had a sparkle to it, because it was clean, it was new, and I think that to some degree that was the part of the appeal of marble. Also, that it was a classical kind of material. It's what you would have found in Greece, right? The Parthenon is built of limestone, but it's called marble, and you start to see all of these images with using all of this marble. This is a needlepoint, 1818. The other thing about marble is not only is it considered an attractive stone, but marble is easy to carve in the round, right? Slate, you can only carve on one side. You can't really even carve. You can more incise. You can get a little bit of relief, but you can't really do all that much beyond that, no matter how skilled you are. Marble, you can carve all the way around, because marble has a crystalline structure, as opposed to slate, which is a sedimentary structure. Not to bore you, but slate is made in sheets, which only makes it useful for one kind of purpose. That's why it's also used for slates and for roof slates and chalkboards. That's the kind of form it allows to be cut in, whereas marble is completely different. And so, in terms of the cemetery and gravestones, what you start to see is a completely new and different kind of vocabulary of mourning and of expression onto gravestones. We really go into a period in the 19th century where we completely leave behind the winged skulls and the emblems of mortality. There is a lot of classical willow and urn in the beginning, but we really go into a completely different sort of era. And in the beginning, marble, stonecutters are not really quite sure about how to deal with how to use the qualities of marble that is possible. And you do see the slab forms for some time, because stonecutters haven't quite figured out yet that they could do more with this new material. So even here in Park Street, you see this slate in the middle here, the second from the right. And then the other three stones are of marble, but they're still in that slab form. But that will change very soon. In the 19th century also is the development of the rural garden movement, the garden cemetery movement, some call it, which is really designing burial grounds to be sort of outdoor museums and parks. It's a place of recreation, of genteel recreation, if you will, coming to reflect upon your loved ones or upon life and to look for a place of serenity. Places like the Granary Burying Ground and any older style burying ground was not meant to be visited. It was more of a practical, pragmatic place. There was some instruction going on with the memento moris of the slate gravestones. You know, this is as I am now, so you will you be someday. Good luck, live a good life. Now we're going into a completely different sort of conception. And the cemeteries reflect that. Now cemeteries are there are green spaces in the urban cities, and they are also green spaces in, you know, out here in the more rural spaces at the time. Very popular, to the point where guidebooks are issued telling people what the proper or what the most scenic routes are to take when you're visiting the cemetery. Cemeteries become a destination for tourists and for inhabitants alike. At Mount Auburn and also at Forest Hills, which was another rural garden cemetery, the cemetery superintendents had to issue passes. So because these cemeteries became so popular on Sundays, people would visit them. They'd be carriage after carriage after carriage after carriage. So they had to limit Sunday visitation only to folks who actually owned lots in the cemetery. I also found some really interesting, it seems amusing to us now, but it must have been a real nuisance then. At Forest Hills, I found the superintendent's notes about how he had to enact a bylaw or a policy of horses could not go more than 5 miles per hour. That there was no galloping, there was no exercising your horses, you had to trot. Whatever 5 miles an hour is, you know, on a horse. Also, there was no rifle practice allowed. No shooting of guns. That was a problem at Mount Auburn as well, because people felt like, oh, there's all this green space. I can do some rifle practice. No, that's not what it was intended for. So it's an interesting. It's a whole other interesting part of American history. So here's Mount Auburn Cemetery about 10 years after it opens, and you can see that it's. There is a marble monument here. This is actually Washington Alston's monument. And then there are people, you know, paying their respects. And there's also a mother with her children. So this is a place of recreation. And it's a place where you should be enjoying yourself. Very genteelly, of course. More Mount Auburn. And this is and I apologize, a very poor stereo view shot of a view at Forest Hills Cemetery. We never figured out why this huge crown of flowers or floral arrangement was planted or designed. We looked at the dates. We couldn't figure out if somebody visited the cemetery, some dignitary. Anyway, there's a mausoleum in that spot now. But you can see someone is just, you know, visiting, just strolling. Children. Children are, of course, some of the most vulnerable populations in the 19th century. And children are actually more vulnerable in the cities than they are out in the country. I'm calling this the country because this was rural at the time. The reason children are more vulnerable in the cities is because there's more congestion. There wasn't an understanding of how contagious diseases work necessarily until later on in the 19th century. Children in Boston, according to public health data in the 19th century, the mid-19th century, represent one-third of Boston's annual mortality, children under the age of five. The age of five was a really critical milestone if you could make it. You know, if your child could live to five, the chances got better that he or she would survive beyond that. Of course, children, died in great numbers beyond the age of five too. But, you know, the older they got, the better their chances of survival. And actually, if you survived until your 20th birthday, your chances were very good that you would live to be what we would consider a really fine old age. It's not unusual. I have people, you know, who come to me and say, geez, I saw this gravestone. This guy was 80 years old when he died. It wasn't that unusual. We're a pretty sturdy people. So if you could reach that 5-year milestone, that was great. If you could get to your 10th birthday, even better. And then if you can survive to 20 or 25, your chances were good. Other than women, you know, childbirth was a major concern. So, children. This is an incredibly moving monument, or series of three monuments at Forest Hills. It's three lambs, okay? Three lambs. This family lost all three of their children. You can see in the middle, it says, our infant boy. I forget what the other ones say. These are lambs that have lost their heads. Not through vandalism, it's just the neck of the lamb is it's a sort of a vulnerable part of the sculpture. But in terms of symbols, lambs were important to designate children, you know, children of God, lambs, the shepherd's flock. And I put there's a little saying right here, and it says, I shall meet them in heaven. So there is this idea in the 19th century of a heavenly reunion, and the family will be reunited. There's more of an emphasis on a more uplifting sort of spirituality, that that there will be grace, we will all find reunion and be together in the hereafter. You see that a lot, but in terms of children, lambs are often the symbol of that. Here's another little lamb. This one is in Medfield, and it says, our little Johnny. The epitaphs on these are almost as moving as the actual sort of symbolic force of the sculpture or of the motif, because if it was an adult, it would have been sort of straight biological information, right? So-and-so, born this date, died this date. Some of these children live such a short time that they don't really even have a date span to put on there. Angels, very important culturally in the 19th century. Angels are mediators between heaven and earth, right? So angels become popular motifs or popular symbols associated with children and protecting babies and children and, you know, taking them under their care and ascending with them to heaven. Just to show you how widespread this imagery was, on the right-hand side is a print from Currier and Ives of the mid-19th century. And it's called The Mother's Dream. You see the bed is empty. This must be a woman who lost her child. And this is what she's hoping for her child, that her child has been taken up to heaven in the arms of an angel. And then on the left-hand side, this is a stone in Bonaventure Cemetery in Savannah, Georgia, where you see almost this identical image. And so you have to believe that these images were circulating in social, you know, cultural, in the culture, and that people understood if they visited the cemetery, they would understand without knowing that a child was buried there necessarily, they would understand that it was a child who had died. You know, if they didn't have the biographical information or the epitaph, if they saw that, it was a sort of a cultural currency, an understanding of what this angel symbolized. Now, angels appear for all kinds of people, all ages, all sizes, but angels carrying babies are especially symbolic and must have provided some comfort to the parents and the grieving family members. Another important set of symbols or motifs are those related to flowers and botanical motifs. If I asked you, how do you know that this is probably a child? What might you think? What's the clue that this is a child? Besides the fact that it says just Tommy.
Oh, okay.
That was the first clue. But there's a very significant clue. There's actually two clues on this stone. It's not a test. I will tell you, but
in that flower. Somewhere.
Yeah. Okay. Number one, it's a bud. What's a bud?
Oh, okay.
A bud is an unopened flower, right? The other thing is, that bud is really wilted. Do you see that? Do you see how it's just, it's dying? So that's one way to show, again, you know, the sadness, the grief that the people, the survivors, the family, the parents, the, you know, whoever are feeling. And that's how powerful symbol, you know, symbolic imagery can be. You have a nice example of this kind of bud at Park Street Cemetery, G. Parker Eaton, and I forgot how old he was. He was only 2 or so. It's a little hard to see, but he's got 2 buds. But they're buds. Those buds will never open. They will never bloom because little G. Parker has died. This is marble, by the way. These are all marbles. This is still a slab form. Another version, not quite the same, doves often denote children. And in this case, this dove is holding a sprig of some kind. Yeah, it's a bud. It's a rosebud as well. Do you see the rosebud? Mm-hmm. Again, an unopened flower. One of the most extraordinary stones that I know of is at Forest Hill Cemetery, because flowers and buds and botanical motifs were not just, you know, for children. They could be really for anyone. But Mary Southwick's stone, 1869, she was about 26 years old, as I recall. This stone was completely hand-cut. There is no machine that could have done that, even today. And there were these books circulating in popular culture called Language of Flower Books, which were essentially lists of flowers and whatever emotion they were associated with. And what I think that Mr. Southwick did, Joseph Southwick did, when he lost his wife, is I think he went to a stonecutter and he said, I want every flower that you can put in here to show how to express my loss, to symbolize my great loss. I've spent hours with this stone and with various Language of Flower Books trying to sort of unpack or decode what this stone is saying. This man, you know, suffered a great, great loss. And I will mention his loss was further compounded by the fact that that little lamb next to Mary Stone is their one-year-old infant son who died just a week after Mary. I don't know what happened. We didn't have any records in the office about what was the cause of her death. But the little baby was a year old, and she died, and then he died a week later. Very sad. So Mr. Southwick was in the position of choosing 2 stones. He chose a lamb for his little infant son. But for Mary, there are chrysanthemums, there are lilies, there are roses. There are many, many different kinds of flowers, and they all meant something to him. It's hard to see in this photo, but all the flowers are actually wilted as well. They're all sort of drooping and falling. They look like they're close to falling off whatever, you know, tree they're on or whatever, you know, was holding them on in the first place. So again, if you didn't know, if you somehow missed the fact that you were in a cemetery and you somehow missed the fact that this was basically a gravestone, you would, once you started to look at this in the 19th century, you would understand what this stone was trying to tell you, or was actually telling you. You would have a dialogue with this stone just because of all of the symbolic nature of these flowers and what these flowers meant. And I also wanted to mention the form of the cross, of course, would have indicated Mary's pious nature. She must have been a woman of faith. Tough to know with crosses, because crosses are mean something different to everybody. Another botanical motif, this one maybe a little bit more obvious, but is the sheaf of wheat. Basically, this comes from the idea of the Grim Reaper having come and, you know, the harvest being in. But sheaves of wheat are actually not as sad as you might think, because they almost always denote, they always denote a mature life, a life well-lived, a productive life, a successful life. So having a sheaf of wheat on your tombstone was not was a sign that you had a, you know, a good run, and that you'd had a good life, and you had a lot of you know, respect. On this particular gravestone, Ariel Lowe's gravestone, there's also a circle of oak leaves, and then a circle of ivy. Oak and ivy are often found together, especially for couples. Which is the case here. Ariel's name is on the front, his wife's name is on the back. There's differing interpretations of what ivy means and what oak means. I've heard people say that ivy must be the woman because it's clingy, it needs something to climb onto. But in fact, ivy was not necessarily for women. Ivy is it's seen as permanently green. It's sturdy. It's long lasting. Oak does signify strength and fidelity, and you know, a lot of other good qualities. But here, you know, these are qualities that are symbolized by the ivy and by the oak. It's what you can make of them, but this is what how people thought of them most of the time. We don't know exactly how everybody thought about everything, but in general, this is the consensus. And you all have a sheaf of wheat right here in Park Street Cemetery. It's a very tiny sheaf, and it's on a slab of marble. But it is for Nancy Eaton, 1875. And here is that little sheaf of wheat, which appears to be resting on some kind of a pedestal. So Nancy was not a young person either. So she was an older person, wife of Captain Thomas Eaton. She was 25. Okay, so she wasn't that old, but she was not a child. So she, you know, she had lived long enough to have a wheat symbol. The most amazing sheaf of wheat symbol is on this monument at Mount Auburn Cemetery. It's enormous, and it's very wild. It's quite a feat of the stonecutter's art. I feel like whoever the family member was who came and commissioned this monument, this is really not a gravestone at this point, this is a really large monument. I feel like that person said to the stone cutting shop, you know, I'll take one of everything you got. And basically that's how they built up this monument, because there's a lot going on with it architecturally and otherwise, which is very beautiful. But I think the wheat is really the symbolic core of the monument. A couple of other things going on here with this gravestone. Number one, it's a cut-off tree trunk. Okay, a cut-off tree trunk signifies the end of a life. Sometimes a life cut short, but usually, you know, just a life that has ended. And you can see, this is actually a man's gravestone, but you can see there's ivy growing up and around it. So now we have this symbol of the ivy, fidelity, evergreen, everlasting. And at the base of the tree trunk, there are also lilies and... Yeah, lilies, which are another motif that you will find sometimes. Lilies, actually, I don't remember what lilies are supposed to be. They mean different things to different people. And lilies. Lilies, purity, innocence, married love, Victorian symbolism for death and mourning. That wasn't that helpful. But anyway, you do see lilies often. This is another lovely stone for a man in Vine Lake Cemetery in Medfield. This lovely bouquet. And I remember finding morning glories, chrysanthemums, lilies. There are poppy pods. Poppies are another symbol of sleep, because poppies are the ingredient for
opium.
Thank you. There, it's an opiate, right? So the ingredient in opiates. Think of the Wizard of Oz when they run through the field of poppies and they fall asleep. That's because, poppies are are part of that opium ingredient. So poppy seeds often come up as a sort of a metaphor, you know, for death, that is sleep. And a few other things, some roses and a few buds, although this gentleman was not a child when he died. But so you'll find these botanical motifs everywhere as well, and you really just have to stop and look and see what you get out of them. Another popular motif has to do with music and the lyre, with the lyre strings. This is an interesting motif at Forest Hill Cemetery. There's actually two things going on here. One is the broken column, which is similar to the broken tree trunk or the cut off tree trunk, you know, the life that has ended or the life has been cut short. And in terms of the music element, do you notice anything unusual about this lyre? You might notice that the strings are broken. And they're lying face down. That's not erosion, that's just the strings end, and then the rest of them have just flopped over onto the front. And those are all carved individually. So another way to show loss, the end of life, mourning, possibly. The music has ended, certainly for the deceased, but possibly also for the person who is missing them. I was at Swan Point Cemetery last week in Providence, and one of my next authors in the next issue of Markers is doing an article on various monuments at Swan Point, so I wanted to take a look. And this is one of the monuments. It's for a gentleman who was a Polish immigré, and he, while he was living in Providence for about 30 years, he became a music conductor and composer. And sure enough, when I get close and look at the his motif, it's a lyre. The strings are all intact, but it is a very beautiful lyre, you know, perfectly proportioned. And around it is a crown of laurel. Laurel is often thought of as victory over death, or you having not immortal, but having lived a good life and having having conquered anything that might have gone badly in one's life. And this fellow actually had a very interesting very busy life, not necessarily a happy one, but he did triumph in the end, according to his friends who paid for and bought this monument. Hands are all over the place. Hands pointing up, hands pointing down, hands pointing at books. This is actually a metal gravestone in New Jersey. I thought it was so interesting, not just because of the hand, but because it's just this sheet of metal that was cast. Apparently, it's iron, and it was done in 1873, I think. But it's kind of an interesting. So hands pointing up, I've gone to heaven. That's where you'll find me. That's where I went. And in Park Street Cemetery, you have a lovely, lovely gravestone with a hand pointing to a page in a book, most likely the Bible. I think, you know, that's how I would interpret it. You're all welcome to interpret it as you see, but typically when we see a book, especially an open book on a monument, carved into a monument, we think it refers to the Bible. So somebody is pointing to a page in a Bible or a book. And at the same time, the finger happens to be pointing upwards.
It could be the Book of Life. His name is written in the Book of Life.
Yes, that's right, and pointing to their name in the book, sure, yeah. Ah, and there's another kind of hand also. You might have figured out right away that we're looking at the grave of a little girl. Lavinia was her name, little Vinnie to her parents. In this case, the hand has come down from heaven and is plucking the bud and is going to pluck it back up, and you know the parents will have to join her in the hereafter at some later point. I love this, with the hand coming out of the clouds and just plucking little Vinnie up to heaven. There's another motif that, you know, or symbol that you will see often on monuments, but unless you know what it is, you might miss it altogether, because it's usually not the focus of the monument. It's usually sort of an added element. There's a lot going on in this monument, which is also at Forest Hills. But what I'm talking about is the inverted torches at the corners of the monument.
These elements right here.
Those elements. Inverted torch is, of course, a reference to the snuffing out of life. These torches have flames, but, you know, much longer, they're going to fall and they're going to get snuffed out. There's a lot of other things going on in this monument that I could talk about, but I'll just say very quickly, this monument is an example of what we call an allegorical figure. An allegorical figure is a figure that embodies an abstract concept. In this case, this figure is known as faith. Faith's attributes, the symbols by which we know that this is faith, is not just her pose, but it's also her anchor, which denotes her faith. And yes, that's her main attribute in this case. There are other allegorical figures like hope and grief, which is usually a woman mourning over an urn. Then this wonderful little vignette in the middle of the monument, we've never figured out what that was about. This is the Tucker, Nathaniel Tucker and his wife, but they never had children, so we don't know what the three little cherubs are doing there. There are no children buried in this plot, although Nathaniel Tucker and his wife bought this plot when they were fairly young and early in their married life, and so we don't know. But this is one of those kind of Victorian, you know, high Victorian monuments that you really can spend a lot of time just sort of studying. Another monument, this one's at Mount Auburn. This is a famous monument known as the Binney Monument. I show it to you just because of the inverted torches, again, that appear under the drapery. And then this example, which is a little unusual, it dates from the 1940s. It's at Vine Lake Cemetery in Medfield. And I thought it was very interesting that this, the inverted torch is sort of an old-fashioned motif by the 1930s and 40s. And I thought it was very interesting that this lot owner chose to have this granite monument built and then have these, just the inverted torches sort of applied to each of the four sides of the monument. It's very stark design, and it's very striking. It's at the top of a hill. And I'm just going to sort of wrap it up here with symbolism that you will probably recognize fairly quickly. And this kind of symbolism comes into gravestone monuments, especially in the Northeast. And in the South, in slightly different ways, after the Civil War, during and after the Civil War. This is the monument for James Parkman and his brother, Franklin Artemus, this is in Vine Lake Cemetery again in Medfield. They died during the Civil War, and their parents erected this lovely, lovely stone. Lot of detail. The stone is broken, it's been repaired. But in terms of symbolism, I don't think it takes a huge stretch to read the stone and see what is being represented, and what, you know, what caused their death or what their death is associated with. In this case, the Civil War. The stonecutter did, again, you know, I have such respect for stonecutters who do this kind of work, who did this kind of work. There's two bayonets. There's a sword. There's the Union Shield, there's the flags, there's a cannon, there are tiny little cannonballs carved into this. There's laurel, by the way, on one side, and some kind of other botanical motif on the other, right there. And just a beautiful sort of assemblage of items that, you know, if you were a visitor to the cemetery, you would know that these motifs of battle or of military usage had something to do with the death of the person or the persons buried here. that's where I'm going to leave it. That's me in the weeds, doing my thing. I'm happy to entertain questions now, or if you want to contact me afterwards, there's my email address. Feel free to contact me. Love to talk cemeteries. Love to talk symbolism. Always interesting, and I always learn something. I always learn as much from you as, you know, you might from me. So thank you very much.
Thank you. We have a Civil War cemetery here in North Reading.
Harmony Vale?
Excuse me?
Harmony Vale?
No.
Oh, the other?
On Park Street.
Oh, Park Street, okay.
Right. And how do you go about getting it into the National Register?
Is that come prepared with you? There is a process.
I'm sure.
And I can point you to the process if I consult with my colleagues at the There's a process, and there's paperwork, obviously. I've just written two recommendation letters for two different cemeteries elsewhere in the country that I'm familiar with, and that I'm they've done the work on, that have both just been entered into the National Register. So I know that I know part of the process. I can write letters. But there's a process of survey, and there's a lot of paperwork you have to fill out. Of course, I don't know if the paperwork is more onerous. It's just as onerous if it's a smaller cemetery as if it's a big one. I don't know, but I can find out for you, Gloria.
Okay.
It shouldn't be a problem.
I know that there's one in North Andover that is in the National Registry.
Right, and they might be willing to share some of how they did it too.
Okay, and. When, some cemeteries, they will not allow any stones, they just have markers.
Flush markers, yeah.
And then, now, the stones can not be too high, if they're allowed. Was it for space?
Maintenance and space, yeah. At Forest Hills, which is, my example, because I work directly with families, and I help them with their monuments, current, contemporary monuments as well. At Forest Hills, space became a big issue. In the 19th century, Forest Hills sold lots, as Mount Auburn, as most rural cemeteries, as most cemeteries did. We sold lots, and people could just sort of bury their loved ones, any way they wanted. It was up to them. Also, there was a technical issue, such as in the 19th century, we only did single depth burial. Well, 20th century comes around, the cemeteries are running out of space. Now they insist on double depth burial, sometimes deeper. But there are consequences in terms of monumentation. You can't put a monument on top of a body. It has to go beyond the grave. Because you just can't do that to whatever's buried underneath. So there's only so much room for monuments, and they have a very specific place. And for maintenance, they do, now graves are 3 feet by 9 or 10 feet long. They're very rigidly laid out. They're actually laid out by architectural, not architect, engineering firms, lay out cemeteries now. I have a couple of images that I do for another talk where I show a section of Forest Hill Cemetery based on a 19th century map. And then I show a similar section that was developed in the 1960s, same exact acreage, and the way it's laid out, it is just jammed. It's just, everybody is just in rows, whereas in the 19th century, they were kind of more artfully, arranged. And so now it's rows, it's very rigid, it tends to be, and that's for space issues, it's for maintenance issues. It's for the cemetery's economic, health. You only get to sell a space once, right? Because what you're buying when you buy a grave space, I'm going to put my sales director hat on, what you're buying when you're buying a grave space is you're buying not the rights to that land, you're buying the rights to be buried in that spot in perpetuity. So the cemetery only sells it once, and they have to make it economically viable for them. That's also why in many cemeteries vaults are required. It's because machinery is very heavy and might cause some collapsing.